I could, of course, talk a lot about the issue of the politics of knowledge systems, but I'm not going to. I'm going to talk about the part of the work, as Claude mentioned, that I've been doing for the last 30 years on issues of biodiversity, food and agriculture, largely because of the recognition that this is the cutting edge of the new colonization and the new imperialism. And I think, when did we do the Samvardhan launch?
1974.
Not 74. 84. Well, 84 is the year, you know, many of us in India got together to build a movement at that point for organic farming. For me, 84 was significant because of two major events, both very tragic. One was in June the 4th, when the Sikh shrine, the Golden Temple, was invaded by the Indian Army, largely because of the unrest and extremism that had built up in Punjab. And the extremists were hiding in the Golden Temple. And later that year, we had the Bhopal tragedy, where a pesticide plant leaked and killed 3,000 people in one night, 25,000 since then. Just last night, I got a message. They were protesting at the only place that's left in Delhi to protest, which is Jantar Mantar, this old observatory near there. And even there, you can only protest from 9 to 5. And yesterday, the Bhopal movement said, no, we're not going to leave. And they were beaten up and arrested. Bhopal, of course, became, I mean, I think it's historically a watershed in terms of the structures of power, part of which involves shedding. First, shedding hazards, and then shedding liability related to hazards. Bhopal is a watershed where sacrificing the rights of people in times of industrial genocide, it starts. And after that, of course, Lawrence Summers, who I think was mentioned by you, Vinay, or somebody. Somebody mentioned Lawrence Summers, who currently is Obama's chief economic economist. The minister mentioned Lawrence Summers. But I first came across Lawrence Summers in 92, when he was the chief economist of the World Bank, because he wrote a memo saying it makes good economic sense to move our pollution and hazards to the developing countries. First, because it's cheaper to find labor, and therefore the costs come down. When people fall ill, it's cheaper. And when people die, it's cheaper because their lives are worth less. So that 3/5 of a human being on the slave issue continues actually in contemporary calculus of what is a life worth. It's because of all these series of very violent episodes, I decided to start looking at what was really happening to agriculture. And in those days, I used to be associated with the Peace and Global Transformation Program that the CSDS used to have, Rajni used to head it. And I'd finished most of the work for the conflicts over natural resources component, but Punjab happened in 84. I asked for an extension, and the United Nations University said, sure. So I decided to study what happened to Punjab. Because, you know, and in the days when all this was happening, first I was young, I was still in school, but I was an innocent physicist, you know, no idea of what was going on in agriculture. A series of things I learned during that study. The first, that agriculture had become the place to extend the war economy. Every input in agriculture is a war chemical. Every agrochemical is a war chemical. Herbicides were used in Vietnam, Agent Orange is now 243D. Pesticides were used to kill people, which is why Bhopal kills people. Fertilizers came out of explosive factories. And the other day I was at some gathering and there was someone who's very close to the US security establishment, and they said Iraq was easy because the weapons were very evident. You know, the weapons had been bought on global markets. Afghanistan is tough because the weapon is fertilizer bombs made from the fertilizers USA distributed. So this is in fact, you know, fertilizer coming back to the original purpose. And of course, it's not just that these are war chemicals extending into agriculture, but bringing them into agriculture is very, very much part of a new imperialism. The common narrative of the Green Revolution is India evolved it, India chose it. The reality of it is the defense labs of the US started to work in the 40s on how do you retool these chemicals for agriculture. When they couldn't work on that, because when you apply the fertilizers to plants, to traditional seeds, the traditional seeds lodge. So you had to change the plant to adapt to the chemicals. And that is what the dwarf varieties for which Norman Borlaug got the Nobel Peace Prize was about. Norman Borlaug, by the way, was part of DuPont Defense Labs before he was put on this agenda on agriculture. The categories that were created at that time, and you were talking about imperialism of categories, Vinay, I think at the heart of it was a very subtle way to define progress and improvement into the new varieties that were adapted to chemicals. And rather than calling them varieties bred for chemicals, they were now called high-yielding varieties. In fact, they were even called miracle seeds. And the first 12 people who Borlaug trained, who were sent around the world to introduce these seeds and chemicals, were called by Borlaug himself the wheat apostles. Literally. So it was miracle seeds and wheat apostles introducing these new seeds. And just as there had been the idea of the empty land terra nullius in the first colonization, in the colonization through agriculture, basically land was emptied of its biodiversity. It was as if there had been no breeding, no seeds, no biodiversity before the Green Revolution. Or what existed was turned primitive. The vocabulary, it, literally even today in breeding, is primitive varieties. What people breed is primitive varieties. What industry breeds is elite varieties. Sometimes they use the word land races, as if these seeds just came out of the land and there was no human element of breeding that went into the amazing diversity we have had. Claude and I both had very deep association with Dr. Risharia, who had done the wheat rice collections for India. And we used to have 200,000 varieties of rice on his account. Of course, there had been an attempt by the British to change agriculture, except that the person they sent in 1905 to India to improve Indian agriculture ended up learning from Indian agriculture and is today called the guru, the master, the father of the modern organic revolution. And we've again jointly published his Agricultural Testament, a book I think anyone wanting to understand agriculture, history, and that forgotten period really needs to read. Hand in hand with the fact that you now had an external drive, a political drive, and you know this whole structure only worked because when these varieties were ready, the US government just was waiting for an opportunity to push them. And it was a drought that took place in India in 1965 that provided that opportunity, because the need for additional imports became the time for imposing conditionalities and saying, we won't send you wheat unless you change your agriculture. And our prime minister of that time said no, Lal Bahadur Shastri. And he died soon after in Tashkent under very mysterious conditions. And the conditionalities continued. The US aid, the two foundations, Rockefeller and Ford, and the World Bank joined hands to create this package of conditionalities. And if you look at what happened, I mean, the country had conditionalities, but downwards, the farmers had conditionalities. You couldn't borrow unless you could prove that you had taken money and subsidy for chemicals. You couldn't get any benefit of any government program unless you could show that you were planting the new seeds. So the Green Revolution didn't spread because of the choice the farmers were making, but because of conditionalities. One more of, you know, Vinay talked about the issue of productivity in the context of terra nullius and the empty land. That same category, in a very manipulative way, has been used in agriculture, linked with the idea of the high-yielding variety, as if other varieties didn't have yields, but also narrowing production to one variety, and then treating the expansion of a monoculture as if it was an overall increase in production. And a lot of my work in the Punjab study was to show that actually food production went down. It did not go up. Rice and wheat production went up, but only because you displaced all the other crops. You know, in an Indian diet, you need your pulses, you need your oil seeds, you need lots of vegetables. All of that disappeared. And now you had a monoculture. And we've done calculations that show that with that kind of monoculture, with our native seeds and organic methods, given the amount of land that the Green Revolution used and given the amount of irrigation and water that was provided, we'd have produced the same amount of increase in rice and wheat. So the increase was allocated to the chemical and miracle seeds, when in reality, what contributed to it was additional land and additional water that was diverted to it. Of course, on the issue of pulses, we had a huge decline in pulses. It's the basic protein for a vegetarian diet. And quite clearly, the West has never understood the value because they've never had pulses in their diet. So when I started to save seeds, and I try and find the English name for our dals, you know, urad dal is the black gram. We've just had wonderful vadas made of it from uncle's home. You didn't have black gram, red gram. You had chickpea, cowpea, horse gram, because the British didn't know how to use it, so they treated all this as animal feed. And we still only have animal feed names for the most important part of the Indian diet. And the other day, Meera came back. She'd collected this package from the local market of a new dal called I dal. Now, in I dal, I like iPod, iPhone, I dal. It literally is a dal only in imagination because it's made of flour and soya flour. And it's colored yellow. And it's extruded. And they have a whole science of this now called analog dals. It'll be the same soya and flour extruded into different shapes and dyed different colors. And we will imagine we are eating different things, but it'll be the same thing.